Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. Edward for our celebration of the first Sunday of Lent. Before we begin, we ask that you please silence your cell phones. Thank you. Our presider today is Father Rick. Please join us in singing our gathering song found in your worship aid, Led by the Spirit.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, as we gather on this first Sunday of this holy season of Lent, we first take a moment to pause and reflect on those times that we've sinned so that we might prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you who call all to yourself, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, who leads us through the trials of temptation and opens the gates of heaven, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you bid us to seek forgiveness of our sins and reconciliation to you. Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their effects. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "See, I am now establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, all the birds and various tame and wild animals that were with you and came out of the ark. I will establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all bodily creatures be destroyed by waters of a flood. There shall not be another flood to devastate the earth. God added, "This is a sign that I am given for all ages to come, of the covenant between me and you, and all living creatures with you. I set my bow in the clouds to serve as a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring the clouds over the earth and the bow appears in the clouds, I will call my covenant I have made between me and you and all living beings, so that the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all mortal beings." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of Saint Peter. Beloved, Christ suffered for sins once, the righteous for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. In it, he also went to preach to the spirits in prison who had once been disobedient, while God patiently waited in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few persons, eight in all, were saved
through water. This prefigured baptism, which saves you now, it is not a removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a clear conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
The Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert, and he remained in the desert for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was among wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. After John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You know, the great thing about Lent is we get a kind of a double welcome or a double introduction into it with Ash Wednesday on the Wednesday preceding the first Sunday, and then the first Sunday is also kind of another welcome into this holy season. So Lent is a great time of the year. It really is. Time of penitence, time of preparation, time of reflection. The changing of the times and seasons within the church year are a beautiful thing. Now, I was reflecting on what are some of the fun things that I enjoy doing as a priest. And there are fun things that are associated with this vocation. Obviously, there are difficult things, challenging things, sorrowful things, but there are fun things as well. I was mentioning just because with the 5 o'clock mass crowd last night, the one particular person to whom I was referring to was in attendance, so I brought it up. Every Monday after, we count the collection, well, I don't, but the collection is counted, we pull for the 50-50. And that's always a fun thing, because the money counters gather around and, you know, see who won. And it's been, how many years have we been doing this? 2 years? I've never won, so. So you know it's not rigged. But there's another one of the money counters who is very invested in winning, and especially as the rollovers happen and the amount gets bigger, really invested. And I thought, boy, wouldn't it be mischievous of me to pull the little wooden squares like Scrabble, but much, much smaller and thinner, and pull the wooden square and call her number, even if it wasn't her number, just to fool her and to tease her. I thought that wouldn't be mischievous, that would be cruel. I think I heard one time somebody did that to some publisher's clearinghouse. They did a thing where they went to somebody's house and they had the balloons and the big check and everything, and it was a fake. But one of the fun things I really enjoy doing as a priest is when a couple reaches a milestone anniversary, a wedding anniversary, when they come up to renew their vows. It could be an early anniversary in their marriage, 10 years or 25 years or 50 years sometimes, even 60 years, couples are reaching as we live to older and older ages. And it's a wonderful moment. I kind of get to stand there in between the two of them as they face each other. And I wonder what they're thinking about, in that moment. Are they seeing each other perhaps as they saw each other on that day so many years or perhaps decades ago when they first made those vows to each other? Or are they thinking about something else? Are they perhaps seeing different things, stages, and events of their life as they look into each other's eyes? And being a man, I have to be honest, sometimes I think about, is the man wondering what's for dinner? Sorry guys, we're men, so it is what it is. But it's a beautiful thing and it's a wonderful moment. And when we think about it, we know that relationships, all relationships, are challenging, are absolutely challenging. And I think, although I've obviously never been married, I think marriage is likely the most challenging relationship of all. Even the best marriages have their difficulties, their disappointments, their failures, hurts, regrettable moments, things of this nature. Yet when two people can struggle through all of that, can work things out, committed to each other, can forgive and ask for forgiveness, can make up after arguments and try to do better, it's a powerful sign to the rest of us, to inspire us to try to be better, perhaps in our marriages if we're married, or in all of our relationships if we're not. Of course, we know that couples don't need to renew their vows or just need to renew their vows at milestone anniversaries every 10, 25, 50 years. But they really need to renew their vows, in a sense, every day of their marriage, if they want their marriages to have the best chance of lasting a lifetime. So now we've entered into this holy season of Lent. And in a way, Lent is kind of a renewal of vows, because it's an opportunity for us to recommit ourselves to a life of faithfulness, to recommit ourselves to a life of discipleship, to recommit ourselves to a God who has always loved us and who will never stop loving us. Unfortunately, though, we don't always see it that way. Sometimes, and maybe perhaps too often, we can see Lent primarily as about, giving something up. We have to give something up. Or having to observe a few extra rules or disciplines, church rules about eating of meat and abstaining and fasting and the like. Or maybe about attending some extra church services or devotions, like the Stations of the Cross, the beautiful Stations of the Cross, or perhaps reading a little bit more of the Bible, focusing on Scripture and God's Word, or maybe being more open to giving to a charity, additional charity or two. In other words, sometimes I think we can focus too much on these external things. But don't get me wrong, these external things that we do during this holy season are good. They are all good and holy things. But we have to remember that they are not ends within themselves. Rather, they're meant to shape and to change and transform us to to be more loving, to be more caring, to be more merciful, and to be more generous people. The outward action is to influence what's taking place, hopefully, within. Put another way, in this holy season of Lent, if it's only for us about the external things, it's only about that. It's not about inward reflection and introspection. We're likely to find ourselves returning from the 40 days in the desert, which this is, exactly the same way as we entered into it. Somewhat unequipped, perhaps, somewhat reluctant, and maybe even somewhat afraid to follow Jesus wherever Jesus is leading us, wherever he is calling us to go. Like couples in a marriage, our covenant relationship with God is not an easy one. I think we know this. I think we realize this. The Lord sets the bar high. We see this throughout the scriptures. Yes, Jesus comes and he's merciful and compassionate and forgiving to the sinner, absolutely. But he sets the bar, he sets the standard of discipleship and holiness high. Our relationship with him demands a lot. And truthfully, it demands our whole selves. Are we that committed that we invest our whole self into this relationship with God? It doesn't mean we eliminate all other relationships. No. It means, in effect or in essence, we help bring those relationships into that relationship with God and to make them more holy as well. One thing is certain. This is one thing that we never have to be concerned about or never have to worry about with our relationship with God. We never have to wonder if God will ever want out of that relationship. God won't. We never have to wonder if God will ever not be fully committed to us. He will. We never have to wonder if God will ever not love us completely and fully. He will. We only need to look to one thing, and we see it every time we come into this church: the cross. The crucifix, to see the permanent, unbounded love that God has for us. And so Lent begins. May we use this time, brothers and sisters, well. May we use it well to show God by word and by action, I still love you more than anything or anyone. I still want to walk through this life, no matter what, no matter what I encounter, hand in hand and heart to heart with you. And I still promise to strive to put your wants for me and your will for me over and above my own. If we take that approach, if we take that approach to Lent, we will emerge from our 40 days so much better than when we began them. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Entering into this holy season and striving to be transformed as we are constantly called to be, we lift up our prayers and petitions.
For your church, may your Spirit lead us to live the gospel more fully, to be a sign to the world of your deep love for all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace to resist temptation, open our minds and hearts to recognize our shortcomings and to rely on our inner holiness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all humanity, may we respect your covenant with all living creatures by striving toward greater stewardship of our air, land, and water. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Comfort and empower all those who live with pain and anxiety, the poor, the homeless, the immigrant, the captive, those who suffer from illness or addiction, all who are confronting death. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring us through this desert time of Lent. Renew our spirits and strengthen our faith, and may this time of Lent bring us closer to you. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Medford and Charlotte Wrench, whom we remember in a special way at this liturgy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Merciful and loving God, hear the prayers we humbly offer to you this day, and answer them according to your holy and perfect will. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
That my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church.
Give us the right dispositions, O Lord, we pray, to make these offerings, for with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable and sacred time. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, by abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrated through his fast the pattern of our Lenten observance, and by overturning all the snares of the ancient serpent, taught us to cast out the leaven of malice, so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mystery, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the
give you praise, Father most holy, for you are great and you have fashioned all your works in wisdom and in love. You formed man in your own image and entrusted the whole world to his care, so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him to the domain of death, for you came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again you offered them covenants, and through the prophets taught them to look forward to salvation. And you so loved the world, Father most holy, that in the fullness of time you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior. Made incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, he shared our human nature in all things but sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, and to the sorrowful of heart joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, he sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may the same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ for the celebration of this great mystery, which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. But when the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And while they were at supper, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We pray.
Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death and his descent to the realm of the dead. We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. And as we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered into one body by the Holy Spirit, they may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis, our Pope, Robert, our Bishop, and the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who take part in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of your Christ and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. To all of us, your children, grant, O merciful Father, that we may enter into a heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with your apostles and saints in your kingdom. There, with the whole of creation, freed from the corruption of sin and death, may we glorify you through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. On you stay. We told this peccatoni, miserere nobis. On you stay. We told this peccatoni, miserere nobis. On you stay. We told this peccatoni.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you
Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Ye are protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and the other evil spirits who prowl about the world for the ruin of souls. Amen. And our vocation prayer, God, our Father, you made each of us to use our gifts in the body of Christ. We ask that you inspire young people whom you call to the priesthood and consecrated life to courageously follow your will. Send workers into your great harvest so that the gospel is preached, the poor are served with love, the suffering are comforted, and your people are strengthened by the sacraments. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Renewed now with heavenly bread by which faith is nourished, hope increased, and charity strengthened, we pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word which proceeds from your mouth. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Some announcements this morning. Again, just a reminder that the Stations of the Cross are every Friday during Lent, 6:30 p.m. in English, 7 p.m. in Spanish. The Knights of Columbus had a very successful drive-through fish fry on Friday. They'll be repeating that this Friday from 4 to 7:30 and all the Fridays of Lent here at St. Edward's. Please take home a bulletin. We will not be able to have a parish-wide penance service, reconciliation service with multiple priests. So I'm scheduling additional hours during the week when I will be in the confessional. So please take home a bulletin. Those hours and days are listed. Also, please note in the bulletin the flock note insert. If you're not on flock note yet, please consider getting on flock note. There's some wonderful new materials that we're distributing, and I've gotten some feedback from a number of people who are really enjoying and appreciating what is being sent. You can sign up, and then if at some point you don't like it, you just say stop, and it will stop. Rice bowls are folded up, and they're in two little plastic containers are available in the vestibule. If you'd like to take one home to participate in the rice bowl program, the CFF word of the day is rainbow. So think of Noah and the Ark, or if you're a little older, think of Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz. And if, okay, I'm gonna see a show of hands. If you're sort of around my age bracket, does anybody remember the rock group Rainbow?
Yeah. Man on the Silver Mountain? Yeah.
Even old man Deacon Bill remembers Rainbow. Wow. Well, I was not a fan, but in the rock and roll world, especially heavy metal, I think Ronnie James Dio and Richie Blackmore were in Rainbow, if that means anything to anybody.
Yes, it does.
I have a brother who's 4 years older than me, and so I had to listen to a lot of that stuff. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
People.